Hello students, today we shall discuss the final chapter in the Egyptian art. We will look at the Middle Kingdom art, New Kingdom art, Amarna period and late Egyptian art 2140 to 332 BC. Our objectives of this lesson is to acquaint about the significance of Egyptian art and architecture in the said period. Understand in detail about the different periods in Egyptian history and circumstances that led to the production of art. Appreciate the art and architecture of the empire in the said period. Contents of this chapter are as follows. Middle Kingdom 2040 to 1640 BC. New Kingdom 1550 BC to 1070 BC. The Amarna period 1353 BC to 1336 BC. Last Egyptian art circa 712 to 332 BC. Let us first look at the art of the Middle Kingdom 2040 to 1640 BC. When the Old Kingdom collapsed, the next 150 years were characterized by political turmoil, fragmentation and warfare. This was referred to as the first intermediate period, circa 2125 to 1975 BC. Around 2010 BC, a series of kings named Mentuhotep, 11th dynasty circa 2010 to 139 BC, gained power in Thebes. Egypt was reunited under Nepetre Mentuhotep. This was the beginning of the Middle Kingdom. Thebes served as the capital and artistic center during this period. The Middle Kingdom was a very huge point in Egyptian history. Arts and writing flourished in the 12th dynasty, 1938 to 1756 BC. Since the country had just emerged from a huge political turmoil, special attention was put on military, and the rulers expanded and patrolled the borders, especially in Lower Nubia. By the 13th dynasty, circa 1055 to 1630 BC, however, central control weakened through a series of short-lived kings and an influx of foreigners. The Middle Kingdom saw a new form of tomb made through rock-cut architecture, built on a ground scale against the spectacular sheer cliffs of western Thebes. The sides of cliffs were excavated to create artificial cave chambers. The masterful design, representing a perfect union of architecture and landscape, unique for its time, included painted reliefs of ceremonial scenes and hieroglyphic texts. Rock-cut tombs became popular with aristocrats and high-level bureaucrats in the 11th and 12th dynasties. And in the New Kingdom later, Thutmose first reigned circa 1504 to 1492 BC, was the first Egyptian pharaoh buried in a rock-cut tomb in the Valley of Kings across the Nile. The forms of the Old Kingdom were retained, but the unity of style was broken. Increasing formalism was combined with a meticulous delicacy of craftsmanship. The paintings of the rock-cut tombs at Bani Hasan are outstanding for freedom of craftsmanship. In sculpture, the sensitive portraits of Sesostris and Amenhat III are exceptional in Egyptian art, which at all other times showed a reluctance to portray inner feelings. Middle Kingdom sculpture is often somewhat more naturalistic than Old Kingdom sculpture. Forms tend to be more rounded and faces show occasional hints of an expression. The portrait of Senusret III exemplifies the new approach to royal representation in Middle Kingdom. He referred to himself as the shepherd of his people, and his portrait seems to show concern. Lines of worry crease the surface of his face, and his forehead forms a slight frown. There are bags under his eyes, and his cheeks are fleshy. This is no longer solely an image of divine royal power. Instead, it departs from earlier conventions of royal representation, and specific personality emerges. On the whole, the sculptures achieved a high degree of realism, even of portraiture. Stelae. It was obvious that only the royalty could make mastabas or rock cut tombs. The rich people commissioned funerary stelae depicting themselves, the family and habits, etc. These personal tombs have contained some amazing records of everyday life and are great records of Egyptian art. Amenemhat sits on a lion-legged bench between his wife Li and their son Antef, embraced by both. Next to the trio is an offering table heaped with meat, topped with onions, and sheltering two loaves of bread standing under the table on the floor. On the far right is the Amenemhat and Li's daughter Hapi, completing this touching tableau of family unity, presumably projected into their life after death. The painter of this relief follows an established Egyptian convention of differentiating gender by skin tonality, and dark red brown for men and lighter yellow ochre for women. A word on town planning now. Although Egyptians used durable materials in the construction of tombs, they built their own dwellings with simple mud bricks. An example of the city of Kahun, built by Senusret II, ruled circa 1842 to 1837 BC. For many officials, priests and workers who built and maintained by pyramid complex, parallel streets were laid out on a grid, forming rectangular blocks divided into lots for homes and other buildings. The houses of priests, court officials and their families were large and comfortable, with private living quarters and public rooms grouped around central courtyard. The largest had as many as 70 rooms spread out over half an acre. Workers and their families made do with small five-room row houses built back along narrow streets. Let us look at some art objects of the period from the Metropolitan Museum. Thank you. Let us move on the new kingdom 1550 BC to 1070. During the second intermediate period, the Hyksos invaded Egypt for the first time and finally conquered Egypt during the 18th dynasty. Thebes was Egypt's religious center throughout most of the new kingdom. Worship of Theban triad of deities Amun, his wife Mut, their son Khons had spread throughout the country. Temples were a major focus of royal patronage, as were tombs and temples erected to glorify the kings themselves. One of the biggest changes of this time was that tombs were no longer in the pyramids, but in tombs carved out of the rock face. Other pharaohs followed suit, building their tombs in what became known as the Valley of the Kings. With other valleys used for queens and princes, these tombs were painted or carved reliefs very delicately and exquisitely, and contained themes such as religious texts or idealized images of everyday life. Let us look at Hatshepsut's mortuary, temple and sculpture. The 18th dynasty is notable for its female pharaoh. Hatshepsut reigned 1479 to 1458 BC, who ruled in the name of her minor son, Thutmose III. One of the main architectural innovations of Hatshepsut's reign was the terraced mortuary temple of Deir el-Bahari. As mortuary temple for both Hatshepsut and her father, the Deir el-Bahari complex reinforced her image as his successor. At the same time, the major deities Amon, Hathor, Anubis were worshipped in shrines within the temple. On the exterior, terraces with rectangular supports and polygonal columns blended impressively with the vast rocky site. Let us now move to the Amarna period, 1353 BC to 1336 BC. Amenhotep IV, 1353 to 1336 BC, radically transformed the political, spiritual, and cultural life of Egypt. He discarded previous religious beliefs and found a new religion honoring a single supreme god, the life-giving sun deity, Aten, represented by the sun's disk, and changed his own name in about 1348 BC to Akhenaten, one who is effective on behalf of Aten. Abandoning Thebes, he established a new capital much farther north, calling the Akhenaten origin of the Aten. Features of Amara art. Ancient Egypt art was generally very formal and presented an idealized version of the subject matter, while retaining some of their subjects' facial characteristics. Towards the end of the reign, Amenhotep III, and throughout the reign of his son Akhenaten, Amenhotep IV, a new, more flowing art form evolved. While it is often described as naturalistic, it remains highly stylized in its portrayal of the human figure. Akhenaten broke the mold in this respect and was depicted with strangely elongated skull, wide hips, spindly legs, and a pendulous breast and a rounded belly. Akhenaten was not the only person to be depicted with a peculiar bone structure. Queen Nefertiti and the princess often emulate the elongated skull and back. The chief sculptor and master of works is depicted with pendulous breasts and pronounced stomach. Bek states on a stele that he was taught by the king and instructed to represent what he saw supporting the suggestion that Akhenaten did have an androgynous figure. However, Beck may have been referring to the glorious depiction of nature and family life and not specifically to Akhenaten's form. Akhenaten's new cult posed a danger to the established priesthood and its traditions. After his death, Egypt reverted to its previous beliefs, reinstated the priestly hierarchy, and revived traditional artistic styles. In this image, the king and the queen are rendered with naturalism, unprecedented. Look at their stomachs for Egyptian royal figures. Their fluid curved outlines repeated in their drapery patterns add a new sense of individual motion within three-dimensional space, which is enhanced by the flowing bands of material behind their heads. The royal couple receives the blessings of the Aten, whose rays and enhance, giving them the breath of life. The king holds one child and lovingly pats her head while she pulls herself forward to kiss him. The youngest of the three perches on Nefertiti's shoulder, trying to attract her mother's attention by stroking her cheek, while the oldest sits on the queen's lap, tugging at her mother's hand and pointing to her father. Let us now look at the famous head of Nefertiti. The proportions of Nefertiti's refined regular features, long neck and heavy lidded eyes appear almost too ideal to be human, but are eerily consistent with standards of beauty in our own culture. The use of the blue headdress and its striped band are repeated in the rich red, blue, green, and gold of the jeweled necklace. The well-preserved paint adds to the naturalistic impression, which is enhanced by the organically molded features. The queen's brows, eyelids, cheeks, and lips are heightened with color, as they no doubt were heightened with cosmetics in real life. The two diagonal planes of the sculpture create a new dynamic tension not seen in traditional pharaonic imagery. Let us now talk about the Tutankhamun's tomb. After Akhenaten's death, the young pharaoh Tutankhamun reigned circa 1336 to 1327 BC, returned to the worship of Amun. He died at the young age of 18, and his tomb with four burial chambers has been discovered intact. Tutankhamun's mummy wore a solid gold portrait mask. It was inlaid with blue glass, lapis lazuli, and other colored materials. Three coffins, one inside the other, protected the mummy. The two outer coffins were made of gilded wood. The innermost coffin was made of solid gold and weighed 243 pounds. The mummy and its three coffins rested inside a large rectangular stone sarcophagus. The canopic coffinet is one of four that contained the pharaoh's organs. These small coffins were housed in a wooden shrine that was placed in another room of the tomb. Their shape conforms to what large coffins, and they also show Tutankhamun as Osiris. Each was made of beaten gold, decorated with inlaid colored glass and semi-precious stones. Let us now look at the rock-cut temple of Ramses II. In the 18th and the 19th dynasties, the Egyptians built their most imposing temples in Nubia. Ramses' purpose in constructing such works in Nubia was to proclaim to the Nubians his identification with the gods Amun and Ra, as well as to emphasize Egyptian domination over Nubia. Let us now discuss painting. All Egyptian reliefs were not painted, and less prestigious works in tombs, temples, and palaces were just painted on a flat surface. Stone surfaces were prepared by whitewash, or if rough, a layer of coarse mud plaster with a smoother gesso layer above. Some finer limestones could take paint directly. Pigments were mostly mineral, chosen to withstand strong sunlight without fading. The binding medium used in painting remains unclear. Egg tempera and various gums and resins have been suggested. It is clear that true fresco painted into a thin layer of wet plaster was not used. Instead, the paint was applied to dried plaster in what is called fresco a secco in Italian. After painting, a varnish or a resin was usually applied as a protective coating, and many paintings with some exposure to the elements have survived remarkably well, although those on fully exposed walls rarely have. Small objects, including wooden statuettes, were often painted using similar techniques. Many ancient Egyptian paintings have survived due to Egypt's extremely dry climate. The paintings were often made with the intent of making a pleasant afterlife for the deceased. The themes included journey through the afterworld or protective deities, introducing the deceased to the gods of the underworld, such as Osiris. Some tomb paintings show activities that the deceased were involved in when they were alive and wished to carry on doing for eternity. Egyptian paintings are painted in such a way to show a profile view and a side view of the animal or a person. For example, the painting to the right shows the head from a profile view and the body from a frontal view. Their main colors were red, blue, black, gold, and black. Let us look at some more artifacts of the period. Now we turn to late Egyptian art, circa 712 to 332 BC. In the beginnings of this period, the Nubian kings of Dynasty 25 dominated Egypt and established capitals at Memphis and Thebes. The late period of ancient Egypt refers to the last flowering of native Egyptian rulers after the third intermediate period from 26th Seth Dynasty in 664 BC. Through a series of Persian and Macedonian Greek conquests that ended with the death of Alexander the Great in 323 BC. In 332 BCE, the Macedonian Greeks led the Alexander the Great conquered Egypt, and after Alexander's death in 323 BCE, his generals divided up his empire. Ptolemy, a Greek, took Egypt, declaring himself king in 305 BCE. The Ptolemaic dynasty ended with the death of Cleopatra VII, 51 to 30 BCE. When the Romans succeeded as Egypt's rulers and made it the breadbasket of Rome. Not surprisingly, works from this period combined the conventions of Greco-Roman and Egyptian art. For example, the tradition of mummifying the dead continued well into the Egyptian Roman period. Thousands of mummies and hundreds of mummy portraits from that time have been found in the Fayum region of the Lower Egypt. The mummy becomes a soft sculpture with a Roman style portrait painted on a wood panel in caustic, hot colored wax inserted over the face. Although great staring eyes invariably dominate images as they had in the funerary mask of Tutankhamun, these artists have seemingly recorded individual features of the deceased. Let us look at some more artifacts from this period. Thank you.